Hachette Audio presents Fortitude, American Resilience in the Era of Outrage. Written and read by me, Dan Crenshaw. This book is for my mom, who taught me true grace and fortitude in the face of suffering, and to my wife, Tara, who taught me love, loyalty, and strength. I would not be here without you. Introduction. Stay outraged. I left my Washington, D.C. office in the Cannon Building to go vote on the House floor of the Capitol, as I usually do multiple times a day while Congress is in session. It was spring of 2019, and I had just been sworn into my first term a few months prior. It was sunny outside, barely above 70 degrees, the air pleasant and crisp, so I avoided the underground tunnels that connect the Capitol to the congressional offices and crossed Independence Avenue above ground instead. It's a far more enjoyable experience to walk toward the Capitol, with its majestic dome in full view, and hard not to be awestruck by the experience of entering the beating heart of our republic. You never know who you will run into during that five-minute walk. Capitol Hill is teeming with journalists, activists, and tourists, most of whom are rather pleasant most of the time. That particular day, I noticed a group of protesters outside the Capitol. This was not an unusual scene. Activists often gather at the steps of the Capitol. It is the people's house, after all. But this was an unusual group of protesters, because it wasn't clear what they were protesting for. There were no calls for the passage of a particular bill or attention to a certain issue. Instead, they wore shirts that simply read, "Stay Outraged," along with a matching assortment of signs and buttons that appeared to be professionally crafted from an established vendor, not purchased hastily from some ragtag print shop. I was puzzled. I wondered about the meaning of their slogan, "Stay Outraged." Why this phrase? Why not instead rally around a slogan that more accurately depicted what they protested or advocated for? Assuming there was one. What drew these young people to the slogan and, more importantly, to the notion that staying outraged was the desired end goal? Perhaps I was simply too unenlightened to understand the value of perpetual outrage? Perhaps, but unlikely. It was more likely that this small group of activists was born of a larger cultural paradigm, one that has permeated our media and national discourse as of late. It was far more likely that the antagonistic headlines of the last few years had finally succeeded in manipulating the behaviors and emotions of our citizens and directed these activists to the steps of the Capitol to encourage others along the same path of indignation and everlasting anger. This aimless rage was deliberately designed, intended to produce this exact result. "It's important to stay outraged," implored the title of a 2019 op-ed, in the hopes that their readers would not fall back into the complacency of their cheerful daily routines. "Get outraged and stay outraged," exclaimed another headline, equally desperate for sustained irritation. "Never lose your sense of outrage," tweeted Senator Bernie Sanders, knowing the most effective political manipulation is achieved by raw emotion. One recent op-ed acknowledged the psychological tax of outrage, giving more in-depth advice. How to hashtag stay outraged without losing your mind. Self-care lessons for the resistance. Outrage is in vogue, they proclaim, and more than that, it is a necessity. But this story of unrelenting ire goes far beyond the abstract sloganeering of politicians and media. Stay outraged is also sprawled on countless t-shirts and stickers and buttons for sale across the internet, as these young activists had clearly discovered. It's a peculiar thought, this notion that if only you were sufficiently informed, aware, and woke, that you would have a duty to exhibit an intense state of fury. The apocalyptic nature of our unjust reality must surely enrage you. It must. Not only that, but once you've achieved an enlightened state of madness, then you must stay that way, perhaps forever. Now, being a normal person with normal concerns, you may read those headlines with healthy skepticism, if not outright confusion. Don't we live in the most prosperous nation on earth, with a quality of life and freedoms that are the envy of the world? "But," respond the outraged, "this is just proof you aren't paying attention." If you only knew the true depths of disaster, despair, and injustice in our midst, you'd rush to join the mob in righteous cultural warfare, scream slogans in solidarity, and march arm in arm to cancel those who disobey, destroy the careers of those who misspeak, and pile on those who dare to defend anything other than outrage orthodoxy. A peculiar thought indeed. Let me suggest an alternative. Outrage is weakness. It is the muting of rational thinking and the triumph of emotion. Despite what you've been hearing and seeing as of late, it is not a virtue. It is not something to be celebrated, nor praised, nor aspired to. It is a deeply human emotion, even understandable at times, but rarely is it productive, virtuous, or useful. It is an emotion to overcome, not accept, and overcoming it requires mental strength. This book is about acquiring that necessary mental fortitude. Let's define our terms. What do I mean by outrage? It is a specific term with a specific meaning. Not all forms of outrage are always unjustified, far from it. There is such a thing as righteous indignation. This book is not about proper outrage, stemming from real tragedy or wrongdoing or injustice. This is not a book about overcoming true grief. It is about outrage culture and the newfound tendency to reflexively assume the worst of intentions when reacting to news or commentary or political discourse, and default into an emotionally driven hatred of the other, whoever that may be. It is the petty, weak-minded, and ultimately unproductive response to our neighbors, fellow citizens, and political opponents that has been normalized and even elevated in our culture. It is about the hypersensitivity that has infected our society, where undesirable language is the equivalent of physical violence, where an old tweet or Facebook post can be grounds for ruination and public shame, and where an absence of reason or fact encourages public indictment, moral outrage, and mob rule. Outrage culture is the weaponization of emotion and the elevation of emotion above reason. It is the new normal, where moral righteousness rises in proportion to your level of outrage. The more outraged one is, the more authentic one is perceived to be. And the more authentic one is, the greater one's moral standing. Reason, rationale, and evidence be damned. My debut in the public eye was premised on an avoidance of outrage culture, a rare thing these days, when I was publicly expected to take Saturday Night Live and Pete Davidson to task for wronging me with an offensive joke. I didn't. More on that later. For now, it suffices to say that mere words could not hurt me, a statement that is becoming less and less prevalent or even desirable to many these days. It was my first personal encounter with modern-day outrage culture, but I am certainly not the first to notice this new and troubling trend. Jonathan Haidt and Greg Lukianoff dissect this new phenomenon in The Coddling of the American Mind. Focusing on college students in particular, the authors find that a culture of safetyism has become widespread, wherein students actually feel that opposing views are a literal danger to their physical well-being. The mantra of sticks and stones is being turned on its head. This false sense of danger leads to extreme reactions to that perceived danger. Students and activists feel justified shouting down others, vandalizing property, and even assaulting political opponents. This sort of emotional reasoning has been promoted instead of discouraged, leading students to see microaggressions everywhere they look. Instead of seeking understanding, people are increasingly interpreting the actions of others in the least generous way possible and assuming the worst of intentions. While Haidt and Lukianoff write about this phenomenon in terms of recent history and the modern terminology that accompanies it, it is not entirely new. I first encountered irrational microaggression interpretations when I was in the third grade, growing up in Katy, Texas, just outside of Houston. We were discussing food chains in class, a fairly simple subject for a third grader. Big animals eat small animals. Small animals eat plants or insects. But being a kid, this explanation was not really sufficient to hold my attention. I built out my own explanation of food chains, using the reality and experiences around me. After all, you master a subject faster if you put it into your own words. And so I went on to describe food chains in the context of our classroom. I pointed to my classmates, one by one, and said, John ate Lindsay, Merrill ate John, and so on. And then I ended my lecture with the final apex predator in my food chain, my teacher. For the sake of anonymity, I'll call her Miss Smith. I said, in perfect earshot of said apex predator, that Miss Smith ate Merrill. It did not go over well. My teacher, Miss Smith, was unable to imagine the audacity of a 9-year-old suggesting she might eat a student, even in the context of discussing food chains. It was clear that she thought I was referencing her weight, despite the fact that I had listed every.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.